Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Okay, so this paper we called Getting More from Morphology and Multilingual Dependency Parsing. This is based on my master's thesis research at UW in CLMS with my advisor Emily Bender, and which we're also presenting at NACL in next month. So I'll start with our sort of research question. Can we use linguistic knowledge of morphological agreement to improve dependency parsing performance on morphologically rich languages? I'll talk a little bit more later about the motivation for that question. But the basic idea is that we have all these languages that have a lot of morphology, suffixes, prefixes, other kind of morphological markers, and we want to see if we can make use of that intelligently. And that's actually what came first, and then I decided that dependency parsing would be a good place to try to apply that. So this is a little overview. Of what we did, we developed, and I'll go into much more detail on all this, developed a simple model of morphological agreement, added it to a dependency parser called MST parser, and tested that on a sample of tree banks, 20 tree banks, and we were able to get accuracy improvements of up to 5.3% absolute accuracy. We found out that some of that was due to our model sort of capturing things that weren't actually related to the agreement that we were trying to model. So when we controlled for that, the improvements were about 4.6%, which is still pretty good. Outline of the talk. I'll give some background on agreement. The Connell shared tasks, which is kind of set the stage for this kind of work. Other related work, and about the parser methodology, some of the changes that we made to the parser and how we implemented that, and the data we collected and how that was prepared. And I'll talk about our experiments and results. And conclude. So to give some background on morphological agreement, there's this idea of morphological complexity, which varies widely across languages, which refers to the amount of different forms that a word can take depending on the case, number, tense, all these different factors. At one end of this spectrum, we have morphologically poor languages. Sort of a canonical example is Chinese, which doesn't really have any morphology. Words don't really take different forms depending on number, on person, any of that. English has a small amount of morphology. We conjugate verbs in a few cases. Pronouns can be different depending on case. Nouns are different if they're plural. The other end of the spectrum is morphologically rich languages or synthetic languages. Canonical example there is Czech, which has, I think, 4 genders and 7 cases, and generally nouns can take different forms for all combinations of those, although some of them are sort of collapsed into so that there's not all combinations are represented. That's a little example with the same sentence in Czech and English, and I can't pronounce the Czech, but you can see that it is the adjective, which is the first word, is inflected for as feminine, plural, and nominative case. The verb, feminine, third person, plural, nominative case. Sorry, that's the noun. And then the verb at the end, third person, plural, and present tense. The same sentence in English, we only have a little bit of inflection for the noun that it's plural. And sort of it's inherently third person, although that's not really marked in any way. And the verb is plural. Because if the verb were singular, it would be grows, not grow. The Connell shared tasks in 2006 and 2007 focused on multilingual dependency parsing. The organizers collected about 12 or 13 tree banks, which were parsed and annotated, and those were distributed. And the participants trained systems on those and tested them on test sets that the organizers provided. The way the parsing was set up, they would start with tokenized and POS tagged sentences, which also have morphological information on them annotated, and predict a head and an arc label for each token. So this is some sample data of what that looked like. for that sentence, we have for each word, the ID is just the index of the word in the sentence. Form is just the word. A lemma, which was not all of the tree banks had lemmas in them, but some of them did. So we ended up using them where they were, if they were there. Then there's two POS fields, coarse and fine. And again, not all of the tree banks had two POS fields. For instance, we use the English pen tree bank. There's only one POS. And I'll talk a little bit more about this later, but we ended up generating coarse POS tags for all those so that we would have two tags for each word. There is a field with morphological information, which is the most important for this work. And as you can see, it just includes information about any inflections or inherent sort of morphological information about the word. The name John is obviously third person and singular, and pizza is singular. That's about all we have in this example. And then for each token, we have the head and the relation, the arc label or the relation type. So just to really quickly go through this, in a dependency parse, we're just looking at the head for each token. And everything is basically headed by the finite verb. So here, for instance, John is the subject. That's headed by 8, which is the finite verb, and that is in a subject relation. So what was found in the Connell task was that morphologically rich languages were the most difficult to parse. A lot of the parses rely really heavily on word order, and as sort of a high-level generalization, morphologically rich languages tend to have more flexible word order because you mark the constituent roles with morphology rather than with word order. So that was kind of a generalization that they came up with, and then there's this quote from the organizers saying that one of the most important goals for future research is to develop methods to parse morphologically rich languages with flexible word order. So that's kind of the starting point for this work, what we wanted to sort of try to tackle. This is a little summary of different approaches to using the morphological information. And a lot of these citations are participants in those Connell shared tasks, not all of them, but most of them. They don't fall too neatly into language independent and language specific, but I kind of tried to group them that way. So if we're looking at these tree banks and looking at an arc, a potential arc between a head and a dependent, and each of those tokens has morphological attributes, we can take each of those attributes separately and include that as a feature for the token. We can keep the entire list of attributes, for instance, if there's person, number, and gender all marked, keep that as one single feature, which makes it a little bit more like a sort of like a really finely grained POS tag. Or we can take all the combinations of the head and dependent. So if they each have three, then we'll combine those in all different ways and sort of use each of those as a feature. More language-specific approaches, we can use morphological information on a token to pick out function words or finite verbs, basically to supplement the POS tags here. If we need sort of more specific information than we can get from the POS tags, adding detail to other features like POS tags. And then there was one, and maybe there was one other approach who actually decided to model agreement. So if two words have the same, are marked the same way for an attribute, for instance, they're both plural, to generate a special feature for that. And that doesn't have to be language specific, which is kind of the idea of our research, but it was done by these people in a language specific way. So I think they only chose a couple languages and modeled a few specific types of agreement. The other work that has been done has been a lot of work by involving Malt Parser, which is not the parser we used, but that's been tested on a lot of different tree banks with a lot of languages, and they've always found that that incorporating the morphological information can give them boosts in accuracy. So that sort of showed us that there was promise for using this morphological information. A little information on MST Parser. There's a citation. They use a machine learning approach. Look at each arc between a potential head and dependent. There's a whole group of features that are generated, most of which, I guess I'll talk about the features on the next slide. the enumerate features at the arc level, estimate feature weights, and save all those, and then to decode, they define the highest scoring parse based on those feature weights. And the linguistic knowledge here is incorporated mostly via that feature design. So the way we were trying to add some more linguistic knowledge was by tinkering with the feature templates. These are the features that are used by MSD Parser out of the box. There's lexicalized parent and child features, a lot of POS tag features involving the word order, the parent, child, surrounding words, intervening words. And then this is a list of the morphological features that it generates, which it's pretty hard to, I guess that's a lot to understand. Basically what that all is the index of the head and dependent and various combinations of the word forms, the lemmas, and the direction of the attachment and the distance to the head or to the dependent. Here's a little summary of our agreement model. We decided to look at two tokens and add an agreement or disagreement feature if the head and the dependent are both marked for the same attribute. In other words, if we're looking at, say, a noun and a verb, and they're both marked third person, then we would just generate a feature that says, this noun and this verb agree for person, and they are related. In the case that we had an attribute that was not matched on the other token, we added an asymmetric feature. So that just said, well, we have a noun and a verb. The noun is marked for some attribute, and the verb's not marked for that at all. So this approach is language independent. We didn't really use any information about the languages. The tree banks were already annotated with morphological information that was generally in a format that we could just use straight out of the tree bank. It represents a kind of back-off. We're losing a little bit of information, which is the actual value of the attribute. If we're, say, the noun and the verb are marked for third person, it doesn't matter that it's third person. What matters is that they agree. So we're just trying to save the useful information here. And it's high level. So we're letting the classifier use agreement as a feature, rather than having to discover agreement relationships as it goes through all the features. These are our feature templates, and I'm a little low on time, so I'll skip those. Sample sentence and features generated. That's a sentence of check, and that's just a list of the features that we generate, which are agreement features whenever two tokens agree, and the asymmetric features when they don't agree. This is the list of the tree banks that we collected. There's a range there. Hindi Urdu has an average of 3.6 morphological attributes for each token, and we included the Penn Chinese tree bank sort of as a reminder that there's this whole set of languages that don't have any morphological information really at all. And then there's sort of a range in between there. To prepare the data, and I'll move pretty quickly through this, We normalize the coarse POS tags. There is a paper by Petrov et al. That suggests a universal tag set. So in the case where there was only one set of POS tags, we generated these coarse tags. And if there were already coarse tags, we sort of normalized them to be from the same tag set. We normalized the morphology so that it would be useful to us, basically just into the form of attribute and value. For instance, case equals nominative or gender equals feminine. And we generated morphological information for the Penn English Tree Bank, which doesn't have any. And we randomized the sentences, used fivefold cross-validation, and averaged accuracy, runtime, and memory usage across five folds. Can skip the projective thing for now. And we ran the whole parser on each tree bank four times, once with the original features sort of out of the box, once with just our features replacing the original features, once with both sets, and once with neither. So the MSD parser, the word order and POS tag features were always retained. It's just the morphological features that we were swapping in and out, our version versus the original version. This again, I have a graphical summary of this on the next page. But what's important to point out, this is the 20 tree banks and the four feature configurations. And what I want to point out especially is that the runtime and features are roughly the same. So this is no morphological features. And this is our set over here. So again, the number of features is roughly the same for our version, which is Agger, the agreement model, and for the for no features. The original version has much higher feature counts and runtimes because so many features are generated. We were able to cut down the size of the feature set a lot. This presents our accuracy results. The way to read this is NoMorph is the original, not the original, it's a version of the parser with no morphological features at all. And that's the blue bar, and then the improvements due to adding each of the other feature sets is on top of that. So in every case, the yellow one is the highest, even if it's only by a sliver. And that's the accuracy using only our feature set. And that performed better than using both feature sets, I think mostly because there were so many features generated by the original set that it was tending to swamp the classifier. Moving pretty quickly through this, this is just sort of what our results generally look like. I should move ahead. The Hebrew data set we used comes with both gold and automatically predicted morphological information. So we ran it on both and basically found that our feature set was a little bit more robust to using the predicted tags and annotations than the original feature set was. The original feature set lost about close to 3%, and ours was closer to 2% when using the predicted tags. I think maybe I will skip over this so we have time for some questions. This is, to summarize it really quickly, we found that our feature set was capturing some information that was not related to the morphology that was improving accuracy because the original feature set didn't have any feature with just POS tags and the ARC label. So we sort of compensated for that and improve the baseline a little bit. So basically, controlling for that, these are our new results, which is just due to the agreement model and not sort of to the ancillary effect that we were capturing with our feature set. So it decreases our improvement numbers a little bit. Comparing to the previous slide, there's a little bit more of a correlation here between the amount of improvement to the top of the yellow bar and compared to the blue bar, which means that we're getting less improvement due to our features, but the amount of improvement we're getting is more closely correlated with the morphological complexity of the language, which is the, I didn't mention that, the x-axis. So on the left, Hindi has the is the highest. Is the most morphologically rich language, and Chinese at the other end is the least. So we looked at the correlation statistically between the morphological complexity of the language and between the improvement we were getting, and calculated the correlation coefficient for that, Pearson's R. And once we controlled for that PPL effect, using just our feature set, we got about 0.75, which is a much stronger correlation, which is what we'd expect. Before controlling for that effect, we were getting a much weaker correlation because that effect that I didn't go into in great detail was, I think, obscuring the correlation between the complexity of the language and the improvement that we were getting. So future work, these are some things we want to work on in the future, and I want to try to get to some questions. The answer to our question we asked at the beginning, yes, we were able to improve parsing performance on all the languages with morphology and reduce feature counts and runtimes. And I guess we have maybe a minute or two left, so.
So you were using gold standard morphological tags, and you showed a comparison on Hebrew with automatically extracted ones. But Hebrew was one of the less morphologically rich languages that you tested. So, I mean, how viable is automatic extraction of these morphological features for more morphologically rich languages?
That's a good question. This was the only data we had that was available for. So it would have been interesting to try it on the more complex languages. We did find that the no-morph version here actually had the worst performance. So when there's no morphological features, that's when we got the biggest hit from using the automatic tags. So that implies that it was more the POS tagging, not the morphological annotations, that was decreasing the accuracy. But that's a good point.
So I assume you did this on first order features and decoding?
Yes. So MSC Parser has second order features about POS tags and word order, but we didn't do any. None of our morphological features were second order. They're all first order.
But do you expect the same improvement? Does it actually cover something that maybe the second order features might cover if you just had, you know, agreement features?
Right. That's a good question. Yeah. I don't know.
All right. Thanks.
Maybe. I don't really know what we have to do here.
Okay. So for our second talk, we have Anthony telling us about Hello, Who is Calling? Can Words Reveal Social Nature of Conversations?
Well, thank you. A bit of a strange title. And at its core, what it was an initial pilot study testing whether there was utility in using ASR for downstream processing, in particular, whether we could get clinical applications running out of this. And it was done between a collaboration between engineering and a clinical side. So, overall, the biggest possible picture what we're trying to... Oh, I'll go over the structure of the speech first. I'll give you a brief motivation and overview of the data that we collected, the corpus, the ASR that we used. Then I'll sort of describe the engineering problem and, of course, some experimental results on top of that. So the biggest possible scope, what we're interested in doing is inferring the preferential, social, and cognitive characteristics of an individual. And the best possible way you do that is directly probe someone's brain. But now that's not too far-fetched. You've got the MRIs, but in a lot of applications, that's not really practical. So we usually have to look at that through some sort of filter. And obviously, speech is a pretty direct model of what people think, how they think, and their cognitive capacity. And there's really two possible ways that you can look at that. You can directly go to the person and ask them their opinions, how healthy they are, etc., or you can observe them in the natural environment. And depending on what you really want out of your data, whether you want subjectivity and naturalness, whether you have design constraints, whether that person has time constraints, you have to pick one or the other. And obviously for this study, we picked the latter, where we're directly observing natural speech in the natural environment. So what would the role of automation be in this? Well, the biggest one, of course, is it's a lot cheaper. If you've got 1,000 hours of recorded audio, it becomes very expensive and time-consuming if you want to do the low-level human transcriptions and processing on this. And the other important thing, especially for our case, was the privacy constraints. If you're recording these people in their natural environment, it could be very privacy-sensitive, and so we don't really want people looking through these conversations. So the current situation of the whole language processing field is they're quite mature in separate areas. At the lowest level, we've got ASR systems trained on thousands of hours of audio. And at the other end of the system, we've got fairly mature text analysis. And even on top of that, we've got a lot of psychology studies that show correlates between various behaviors and how language is used. So unfortunately, the literature is kind of sparse on testing that full pipeline, whether there is utility in using ASR transcripts right down at the end to see if you can find out clinical outcomes. And really, word error rate is not the end goal here. So the big probing of this study was to see how sensitive was our application to word error rate, whether we could deal with 10% word error rate or even 50% word error rate. So our specific application that we're interested in is we're looking at elderly individuals to track cognitive health, health outcomes. So the overall goal was to track these people and track their language use as they age or whether they develop dementia. So the clinical side of it, optimistically, we'd want to provide a fully automated pipeline for diagnosing these individuals, or at least flagging them when they possibly susceptible to developing dementia. But more pragmatically, we're just trying to find correlates and possibly provide a first-pass screening tool to see if we can map dementia onto the natural language record. On the actual engineering side of things, which is what my rest of my talk will be mostly on, we're looking at to see if we can efficiently, reliably, and anonymously infer the type and frequency of social conversations. And as an additional point, are there any markers that are unique to the automated route? So the corpus that we collected is focused on the telephone usage of these individuals, and they're all healthy, 75 years or older. The important thing here is that these are not subjects that we collected in isolation. These are part of an OHSU cohort that are already researching Alzheimer's-based effects. So there's parallel data series of MRIs, clinical assessments of their physical health, mental health, and activity reports. So very dense longitudinal records. And the overall goal is to sort of do a backtrack of health outcomes. Track these people 1 year into the future, 5 years into the future, 10 years into the future. See what sort of health outcomes they have, and then go back to the language record and see if we can find correlates or at least markers that give good indication. So the core of the study was to propose an additional telephone series on top of this. And on top of the acoustic information, the actual audio channel, we record the surface information, the call times, durations, the numbers that they called, etc., etc. So the reason why we actually started probing the telephone conversations is firstly, it gives a direct insight into the capacity for independent living, which is one of their main clinical outcomes that we're trying to look at. Secondly, it's quite a convenient channel to look at. They purposely use the telephone, and it has a fairly high SNR, relatively speaking. And the age demographic still uses telephones, which is probably the only demographic that still does it. And they use it quite a lot, as I soon show you. So our initial run was 10 individuals over 12 months, and that was about 12,000 individual calls. And so that works out to be about 3 or 4 calls per person per day. So it's quite extensive usage. And the interesting thing is we recorded all telephone conversations, all incoming, all outgoing conversations for 12 months. So a very dense record. And on top of that, we did enrollment and exit interviews just so that we could get out a few baselines for our ASR system. Currently, we're collecting additional homes, so we've enrolled 45 more people, and it's up to so far 50,000 conversations and about 2,500 hours. So it is quite a large corpus at the moment. So I mentioned before that we're trying to see what sort of utility we can get out of ASR. And the ASR system we developed, it's nothing too special. There's no frills. We just wanted a standard sort of out-of-the-box ASR system. So it's a standard switchboard Fisher maximum likelihood. It's got some adaption, speaker adaption, trigram model. And a very, very conservative estimate would be 30% word error rate. So that would be a flaw. More realistic, it's probably pushing around 50% word error rate. So you're thinking about 1 in every 3 words is just completely incorrect, or 1 in every 2 words. So still a pretty hefty error that you'll get out of this sort of domain. So to the actual engineering problem that we had, the telephony surface records provide you a lot of useful information, what number they called, how often they called that person, and you can develop sort of social networks out of this information. Unfortunately, a lot of the high-level labels are still missing or incomplete. And what I mean by that is, are they calling family members? Are they calling friends? What sort of communications are they having? Is it just straight-up formal business communications, or is it more friendly social chit-chat? And that's what we're really trying to get at with this data set from the clinical side of things. So as I said before, ASR error is pretty significant on this sort of open domain. And what we're trying to do is, what is the sensitivity of the downstream analysis on this error? What features are robust? What sort of inferences can we still make? So our primary goal here was we sort of did contrive some classification experiments, whether we could determine business calls from residential calls, whether we can tell family calls from non-family calls, and whether we can tell if they're calling a familiar contact or someone that they haven't called before. And also an additional one, trying to tell family calls apart from just friends and other residential lines. So what we needed to do was process raw transcripts in a useful and anonymized format. So the only way that we managed to collect this information was that we promised not to directly listen to their telephone conversations, and we promised not to directly read transcripts of these conversations. So the first order sort of classifier that you can think of is just a straight up n-gram, content of words. After doing a little bit of normalization on the transcripts, if we remove stop words and also get rid of the rare tokens, we can form a pretty good baseline system. So just some pre-processing, we built 50-50 partitions and we used some cross-validation training. So the n-grams surprisingly give very good performance classification-wise, and they're all around about the same sort of region here, but as you can see from the business and residential lines, we can classify it with about mid 80% accuracy, which is quite good for possibly 50% word error rate. The other tasks are a little more difficult, so telling family members apart from non-family members, but still relatively high accuracy, well above the chance 50% baseline. In terms of the actual n-grams, the unigram actually did the best, which is not too surprising. That was about a 10,000 size dictionary. Bigrams do a little worse and trigrams really start dropping. That's not too surprising. If you have a 30% word error rate, that's going to have pretty bad trigrams. Some other somewhat surprising results is the linear SVM did a little worse than a nonlinear kernel. And if we add in surface features, the time of that they made the call, etc., how long they made the call, it added very little classification utility to it. So it looks like you can get most of the contextual utility out of just the ASR transcripts, whether they're errorful or not. So I sort of papered over how I truncated a lot of those unigrams. Essentially, if you got a very poor estimate, if they appeared in only one or two conversations, so a rare word, we dropped it. If you don't do that, you get very bad accuracy, instantly take a 15 to 20% hit. So you can ask the question is, what sort of additional robustness can you gain through some sort of linear dimension reduction? And there's a few flavors that you can look at there. You can do an a priori mapping. You can do two types of data-driven mapping. You can do supervised and unsupervised. So for the a priori mapping, we went to a social psychology study, and it's called a linguistic inquiry and word count. And it sort of tries to map words down into 60-ish categories of happy words, activity words, negative emotion words, etc. And it didn't do particularly well. So it wasn't really trained on any sort of robust mathematical reduction. If we move towards data-driven ones, we looked at latent semantic analysis, and that did much better, even if you reduce it down to about 10 semantic features. And if we use a supervised approach, so mutual information, just prune out the features that have low mutual information, you get even better results. So with a dictionary of 250 words, you can still tell these classes apart quite well. And what that shows is there's great utility in using ASR because you can collect a lot of information and the data-driven techniques do work quite well. So this asks another question. The ASR transcripts are clearly not accurate, but they do seem to be quite consistent. So even if they don't tell you exactly the right content, they are consistent enough that you can train a decent classifier. So another question you can ask is, will structure-based features work? So part of speech tags, would that work on a 50% error rate transcript? And it turns out they actually do quite well. If we use a part of speech bigram, You do take a big hit over the content-based features, but still there's a surprising amount of utility there. And that actually does better than the psychology dictionary in a lot of cases. So, and that's a pretty crude representation of a whole conversation. If you try mixing it in with the content-based features, it generally doesn't work. So content features pretty much supersede everything else here. So now that we've got a sort of good baseline, you can start asking a few questions about how these conversations are structured. So an interesting one that we looked at is, where does the actual utility come from? Does it come from the start of the sentence, the end of the sentence, or does it randomly distribute it all over? So on this plot, the first group of every bar plot is samples taken from the start of the sentence, the middle one is from the end, and the third bar is just a random segment. And we go ramp up the size of the segments. So you can see with a 30-word opening, you can get pretty much all of the utility straight away. This is a business residential classifier, by the way. The end of the sentence or random segments of the conversation are not too good until you get up to very large sample sizes. So I just showed there that you can get good classification with a forced 30-word window. And that's sort of contrary to general results that show results negatively correlated with the conversation length. You'd normally assume that if you had a long conversation, you'd have very robust features and you should get better results. But it turns out opening of short and long conversations are fundamentally different. So if we look at the accuracy stratified into conversation length, this is the straight up unigram. So again, you can see the trend. Very short conversations, relatively poor accuracy at 75.8. Long conversations, quite good accuracy at 93.8. The interesting thing is, if we truncate that down to a 30-word window at the start, you still get the same picture. So if someone's going to have a long conversation, for example, they just more clearly enunciate their reasons for calling. So to sort of wrap up, we looked at whether there was merit in using ASR transcripts, and it does turn out that you can derive quite a lot of utility even if you have very high word error rates. So fidelity doesn't seem to be the prime mover here, it's just consistency of your recognizer. And you can make inferences with surprisingly small samples. 30-word dictionary, 1,000-word, a 30-word opening with a 1,000-word dictionary. And in future work, we've yet to look at lower-level acoustic features like prosody, talking rate, etc. All right. So.
Hi, did you take a look at the errors to see in the recognition whether it's like consistently missing words, like I'll never get the word school out of the recognition, or is it like half the time I get school, half the time I miss something else, and they're kind of...
Not directly. The way that we measured word error rate is we enrolled them in an interview, and that was very structured, and they were the only transcripts that we were allowed to look at. So it was very sparse, and that word error rate that I quoted was very much an extrapolation. So I can't actually answer that question too well.
I have a question about how you determined your stop words. So some stop words are actually useful for social, distinguishing social interaction. So you might not want to throw away everything.
Partially just through flagging common words and then me going through and sort of pruning out ones that I a priori knew weren't too useful in the context. So and the.
Very interesting work. I have a question about your bigram and trigram model. So basically you're saying your ASR is consistent even if it made some errors. So I'm wondering if you have tried any smoothing techniques for your bigram and trigram, because it seems like your unigram works the best in this case.
So I did do some Laplace smoothing, and it did slightly better, but not significantly so. So I sort of just chopped it down to a lower dimension feature and just left it at that. It seemed robust to quite a lot of different pruning and smoothing techniques.
So now Shafiq will tell us about a novel discriminative framework for sentence-level discourse analysis. Thanks.
Hi. So in this talk, I'll be presenting a novel discriminative framework for sentence-level discourse analysis. But as we'll see that, our approach can easily be extended to multi-sentential text. I'm Shafiq Jyoti, and this is a joint talk with my advisors, Dr. Giuseppe Cainini and Dr. Emoning. So now let's see the problem first. So we are following the rhetorical structure theory of discourse, which posits a tree-like discourse structure. So for example, given this sentence, the bank was hamstrung in its efforts to face the challenges of a changing market by its link to the government analysts say. The corresponding discourse tree is this. The leaves of the discourse tree corresponds to the contiguous atomic textual spans, which are called elementary discourse units, or EDU. Then the adjacent EDUs, or the larger spans, are connected by an rhetorical relation. For example, here, the first two clauses are connected by an elaboration relation. Then the larger span is connected by an attribution relation. Then the span in a relation can be either a nucleus or a satellite, depending on how central the message is to the author. So what are the computational tasks in RST? Given a sentence like this, the first computational task is to break this text into a sequence of EDUs, which is called discourse segmentation. Then the next task is to link these EDUs into a labeled hierarchical tree, which is called discourse parsing. Here, one important thing to note that the fact that here the EDU 1 and 2 are connected by an elaboration relation will have an effect on the higher level relation, on the attribution. This kind of dependencies we call hierarchical dependencies. Again, if we had 4 EDUs and the relation between EDU 1 and 2 will have an effect on the relation between the third and fourth. So these kind of dependencies are called sequential dependencies. So we need to model these kind of dependencies into our model. Now, what's the motivation for this rhetorical parsing? Our main goal is to build computational models for different discourse processing tasks in asynchronous conversations. That is, conversations where participants collaborate with each other at different times, like emails or blogs. So we are mainly interested in topic modeling, then dialogue act modeling, and rhetorical parsing. So we built on unsupervised and unsupervised topic segmentation model to find the topical segments in an asynchronous conversation. Now we are working on topic labeling, so do come to our poster to know more about this work. And we built an unsupervised model to cluster the sentences based on their act types, like question or answer. Right now, we are working on rhetorical parsing. So this talk is a part of this project, but we'll only show the results on 2 monologue corpora. And it has been shown to be useful in many applications, like text summarization, then text generation, sentence compression, and question answering. And we'd like to perform the similar task in asynchronous conversations, like emails and blogs. So here's the outline of my today's talk. I'll first briefly describe the previous work. Then I'll present our discourse parser, followed by the discourse segmenter. Then we'll see the corpora or data sets on which we performed our experiments. Then we'll see the evaluation matrix and the experimental results. Finally, I'll conclude with some future work. So Sorikat and Marku first presented the publicly available space system that comes with probabilistic models for discourse segmentation and discourse parser, sentence-level discourse parser. They take a generative approach, and their model is entirely based on lexicosyntactic features extracted from the lexicalized syntactic tree of the sentences. However, when they model a constituent in a discourse tree, they assume that the structure and the label are independent. And they do not model the sequential and hierarchical dependencies between the constituents. Recently, Harnaut et al. Presented the Hilda system that comes with both segmenter and a document label parser. Their model is based on SBMs. In their parser, they use 2 SBMs in a cascaded fashion, where the job of the first SBM is to decide which of the 2 adjacent spans are to connect. Then, once this is decided, the job of the upper level SBM is to connect these two this spans with an appropriate discourse relation. So as you can see that their approach is a greedy approach, and they don't model the sequential dependencies. Now, all these works, like these two works, are on newspaper articles. On a different genre of instruction manuals, Subba and DiGenio presented a shape-reduced parser, and their parser relies on an inductive logic programming-based classifier, and they use rich semantic knowledge in the form of compositional semantics. However, their approach is not optimal, and they do not model the sequential and hierarchical dependencies. On discourse segmentation, Fisher and Rourke, they use binary log linear model, and which performs the state-of-the-art segmentation performance. And they show that the features extracted from the parse trees, like syntactic trees, are indeed important for discourse segmentation. Now, let's move on to the discourse parsing problem. So for now, just assume that the sentence has already been segmented into a sequence of EDUs. For example, here we have three EDUs in the sentence. The discourse parsing problem is to decide the right structure of the discourse tree. So we have to decide whether EDU 2 and 3 should be connected into a larger span, then that larger span should be connected with EDU 1, or EDU 1 and 2 should be connected, then the larger span should be connected with EDU 3. So you have to decide the right structure and the right labels for the internal nodes, which varies on the relation and the nuclearity status of the spans. So our discourse parser has two components. The first one is the parsing model that assigns a probability to all possible discourse trees for a sentence. Then the job of the parsing algorithm is to find the optimal tree. Okay? So what are the requirements for our parsing model? We want to have a discriminative model because it allows us to incorporate a large number of features, and it has been advocated that the discriminative models are in general more accurate than the generative ones. We want to jointly model the structure and the label of a constituent. We want to capture the sequential and hierarchical dependencies between the constituents. And furthermore, our parsing model should support an optimal parsing algorithm. So here's our parsing model. Just assume that we are given a sequence of observed spans at level I of the discourse tree. Remember that we want to model the structure and the label jointly. So we put a hidden sequence of binary structure nodes on top of this. So here S3 denotes whether this span 2 and 3 should be connected or not. So this is a binary node. Then on top of this, we put another sequence of hidden sequence of multinomial relation nodes. So here R3 denotes if span 2 and 3 are connected, then what should be the relation? So here you can notice that we are modeling the structure and label jointly. Now, this is an unreacted graphical model. Now, if we model the output variables, that is the structures and the relations directly, this is basically a dynamic conditional random field. And we are modeling the sequential dependencies here. Now, you may be wondering how this model can be applied to obtain the probabilities of different discourse tree constituents. So here it is. We'll apply this model at different levels and compute the posterior marginals of the relation structure pairs. So for example, just consider that we have four EDUs in a sentence. Then here's the corresponding CRF at the first level. Then we apply this CRF and compute the posterior marginal over this constituent, then this constituent, then this constituent. Now, the second level, we have three possible sequences. In the first sequence, where EDU 1 and 2 are connected in a larger span. So here, this EDU 1 and 2 are connected in a larger span. So here's the corresponding CRF. We compute the posterior marginals over this constituent, then this constituent. The other possible sequence is where EDU 2 and 3 are connected in a larger span. So here EDU 2 and 3 are connected. So here's the corresponding CRF, and we compute the posterior marginals over this constituent and this constituent. The third possible sequence is this. So here EDU 3 are connected in a larger span, and the corresponding CRF is this. We compute the posterior marginals over this constituent and this constituent. At the third level, we have two possible sequences. In one, where EDU 1, 2, 3 are connected in a larger span. This is the corresponding CRF. We compute the posterior marginals over this constituent. Then again, where EDU 2 through 4 in a larger span, we compute the posterior marginal over this constituent. So by computing posterior marginals, we will have all the probabilities for all the discourse tree constituents. Now, these are the features used in our parsing model. Most of the features are from the previous work. We have eight organizational features that mainly capture the length and position. Then we have eight n-gram features that basically captures the lexical and part of speech features. We have five dominant set features, which has been shown to be useful in a SPADE. Then we have two contextual features and two substructure features. In the substructure features, we are incorporating the head node of the left and right rhetorical subtrees. So by means of this, we are actually incorporating the hierarchical dependencies into our model. Now, once we know how to derive the probabilities for different discourse tree constituents, the job of the parsing algorithm is to find the optimal tree. So we have implemented a probabilistic SQL-like bottom-up parsing algorithm. Now, for example, we have four EDUs in a sentence. Our, the dynamic programming table will have 4 into 4 entries, and we'll be using just the upper triangular portion of the dynamic programming table. So here, Tij will store the probability of this constituent, and m is the argmax over the possible structure, and r is ranges over the relations. So as you can see that, we are finding the optimal based on both the structure and the relations. So this approach will find the global optimal discourse tree. Now at this point, we have already described the discourse parser, assuming that the text has already been segmented into EDUs. Now let's see our discourse segmenter. So the discourse segmentation problem is, given a text like this, we want to break the text into a sequence of EDUs like this. And it has been shown that inaccuracies in the discourse segmentation is the primary source of inaccuracy in the discourse analysis pipeline. So we should have a good discourse segmentation model. So we frame this problem as a binary classification problem, where for each word except the last word in a sentence, we have to decide whether there should be a boundary or not. And we are using a logistic regression classifier with L2 regularization. And to deal with the sparse boundary tags, we are using a simple bagging technique. Now, these are the features used in our discourse segmentation model. You can find the details in the paper. We are using the SPADE features. Then we are using chunk and part of speech features. We have some positional features and contextual features. Now let's see the data sets or corpora. Now to validate the generality of our approach, we have experimented with two different corpora. The first one is the standard RSTDT dataset, which comes with 385 news articles, and it comes with a split of 347 documents for training and 38 documents for testing. In sentences, we have 7,673 sentences for training, and for testing, we have 991 sentences. And we are using the 18 coarser relations, which has been used in the previous work. And by attaching the nuclearity starches with these relations, we get 39 different distinct discourse relations. Our other corpus is the instructional corpus developed by Subba and Di Eugenio. It comes with 176 instructional how-to-do manuals, and it has 3,430 sentences, and we are using the same 26 primary relations and treat the reversal of the non-commutative relations as separate relations. So in our case, the relation preparation act and act preparation are two different relations. And by attaching the nuclearity statuses, we get 70 distinct discourse relations. Now, what are the evaluation metrics we are using to measure the parsing performance? We are using the unlabeled and labeled precision recall and F measure as described in Marcus' book. For discourse segmentation, we are using the same approach as taken by Sorikat and Marco and Fisher and Rourke. That is, we measure the model's ability to find the intra-sentence EDU boundary. So if a sentence contains three EDUs, that corresponds to two intra-sentence segment EDU boundary, we find the model's ability to find these two intra-sentence EDU boundary. Now here are the results. Let's first see how the model performs when it is given, how the parser performs when it is given main-goal segmentation or goal segmentation. So here's the result. Now, one important thing to note that the previous studies mainly show their results on a specific test set. So to compare our approach with their approach, we have shown our results on that specific test set, but for generality, we have also shown our results based on tenfold cross-validation on a specific corpus. So here you can see on the RST-DT test set, our model, like this DCRF model, consistently outperforms SPADE, especially on relation, it outperforms SPADE by wide margin. And our results are consistent when we do the tenfold cross-validation. And if you compare with the human agreement, our performance in relation labeling is much closer to the human agreement. And on the instructional corpus, the improvement is even higher in all these three metrics. Now let's see the results for discourse segmentation. So here you can see on the RST-DT test set, our logistic regression-based discourse segmenter outperforms Hilda and SPADE by a wide margin. And our results is comparable to Fisher and Rourke's result on the same test set, but we are using fewer features. So it's more efficient than that in terms of time. And when you see the tenfold cross-validation, we get the similar results. On the instructional corpus, our model performs outperforms SPADE by a wide margin. Now, if we compare the results between these two corpora, you can see that there is a substantial decrease in the instructional corpus. It may be due to the inaccuracies in the syntactic parsing that we are using, and also maybe the tagger that we are using as features. Yeah. So now let's see the end-to-end evaluation of our system. That is, when the parser is given the automatic segmentation. So here are the results. On the RST-DT test set, our model outperforms SPADE by a wide margin. And we get similar results when you do the tenfold cross-validation. And on the instructional corpus, there is a substantial decrease, but we cannot compare with Suba and Eugenio because they do not report their results based on an automatic segmentation. So, yeah. However, if you compare the results between these two corpus, you can see that there is a substantial decrease. It's due to the inaccuracies in the segmentation. Okay. So we have also performed an error analysis on the relation labeling, which is the hardest task. So here's the confusion matrix for the discourse relations. So the errors can be explained by two phenomena. One is the most frequent ones confuse the less frequent ones. For example, here, elaboration confuse the summary. And the other one is when the two discourse relations are semantically similar, they tend to confuse each other. So we need a technique like bagging to deal with this imbalanced distribution of the relations, and we need a more rich representation, semantic representation like subjectivity or compositional semantics. Okay. So to conclude, we have presented a discriminative framework for sentence-level discourse analysis, and our discourse parsing, our parsing model is discriminative. We capture the structure and label jointly. We capture the sequential and hierarchical dependencies, and furthermore, our model supports an optimal parsing algorithm. And we have shown that our approach outperforms the state of the art by a wide margin. Now, in the future work, we would like to extend this to multi-sentential text, apply to asynchronous conversation like blogs and emails, and we would like to investigate whether segmentation and parsing can be done jointly or not. Yeah. So that's it. Thanks.
Yeah. You go back to your slides around 12, 13, where you show the parser.
Yeah.
I go back. So I just want to know, right here. Yeah. So during the process, when you build up layer by layer,
yeah,
level by level, do yeah you make all possible adjacent
yeah
of words?
Yeah.
And then you compute the score that determines whether you want to merge
that or not. I take all possible sequences. So here's at the level 4, we have two possible sequences. This one is one, this is the second one.
Yeah, but that's very large, right? You do, I mean, you can have 1 to 4, 1 to 5.
But the spans can be just only the adjacent spans can be connected.
Oh, I see. Okay.
So here you can see 1 to 3.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So now the score is based upon the posterior probability.
Yeah, the posterior probability.
Dynamic RCF. Yeah. So that looks very, very similar to this recent work done by the parsing method by Stanford group.
The feature-based CRF?
It's a neural network-based. It's a deep neural network-based. It's Chris Manning and Andrew Ng's group. I think the difference really lies in how do you compute
the posterior
score that determines whether you want to merge or not. And that's actually the most crucial one.
We are not aware of that, though.
You're not aware of that? Okay.
Yeah.
We can follow up with that afterwards. Yeah. That'd be great.
Yeah.
One more quick question.
So I'm not really familiar with RST, and I'm curious how it handles spans that are not continuous. For example, this talk, which covers a work on RST, was just ended, or something like that. When you have elaboration, So I can think of in language some spans are not continuous.
Yeah. So there is a graph theory of discourse that poses the discourse structure should be a graph, not a tree. Mm-hmm. So yeah, there is a recent work on this, but there is no computational method as of it that can, achieve.
But in this case, the spans will look like the spans will be defined on.
The
EDUs.
The EDUs can be separated, not necessarily adjacent. Yeah.
Okay,
thanks.
So for our last speaker, Ryan will tell us about measuring the divergence of dependency structures cross-linguistically to improve syntactic projection algorithms.
All right, so that's a bit of a mouthful, but this is work that I did with Fei Sha and Will Lewis, UW and MSR. I'll just go right into it. So right now there are thousands of languages in the world. And most of those don't have a lot of resources. Most of NLP is focused on a handful of few that do have large annotated corpora. Cost of creating new corpora for most of the world's languages is a pretty limiting factor. So there is some previous work where we can project annotation from one language that does have the resources available to a language without those. But that annotation is generally of limited quality due to the differences between the languages. And it's not easy to tell beforehand the potential that the adaptation will have from one language to another without specifically knowing facts about those languages and how they differ. So this work, we want to look at the impact of common divergence types, differences between the languages, and how that affects projection accuracy, and hopefully improve it. So I'm going to start with a review of the previous work on projection and linguistic divergence. Then I'm going to take a look at how we detect and measure that divergence, and then the experimental results, and conclude. So we use dependency structures for this task. They abstract a little bit away from some of the issues that phrase structures might have, where it's order sensitive and has internal representation nodes that might not map so well. This kind of distills it down to the basic structures so that we can really see the core differences. So I'll just a quick run through of basic projection algorithms where we start with a bitext, in this case, English and Hindi. First we get the word alignments. Then we go ahead and we can run a monolingual parser on the English side and get an English dependency structure. Then we just use those word alignments and make a pseudo-Hindi dependency tree, assuming that the structure resembles that we see in the English side. So projection allows us to take annotation from a resource-rich language and project it to one that has none using the word alignment to bootstrap it. It's got the obvious advantage of we can do this with parallel text if we have the resources available for one language on one side of the bytext. Unfortunately, this relies on what Hua et al. Called the direct correspondence assumption, that when a word is aligned between one language and the other, that essentially they have the same syntactic and semantic meanings. Obviously, that's not the case always. So linguistic divergence is cases where the direct correspondence assumption is violated. So Doerr's 1994 paper outlines a number of types of divergence that can occur between languages. I don't have time to go into all of them, so here's just one of demotional divergence. So in this case, the like that's the head of the English dependency tree here gets demoted as it categorically shifts with the head of the German sentence, which is eat, and becomes a different category. That noun on there is actually wrong. It should be kind of adverbial. And we get a mismatch between the dependency structures. So Dorr's divergence types are handy, but they really require language-dependent knowledge. You really have to know that that's something that occurs in German versus English, and write that into whatever you're doing. So we'd like to see if we can discern kind of the frequencies and the types that happen between these between language pairs, and see if we can do that programmatically, kind of with minimal knowledge about the language pairs. So the first thing that we have to kind of figure out is define what we mean by similarity. When you're looking at two trees, most tree similarity metrics assume that you're looking at two representations of the same string. When we're looking across languages, we're actually going to have a different number of terminals, so those metrics may not necessarily come out to match, even though they're representing the same thing. So in this case, we want to count the number of matching edges between trees as made by the word alignments. So the similarity for a tree pair, S and T here, is the percentage of edges in one that match in T as defined by those aligned words, where the children aligned and the parents of those children are aligned. The similarity for the whole tree bank is defined just as the percentage over the trees. So we have a number of different alignment types that we see frequently when we're looking through the trees. We have the merge alignment, where multiple words in one side map to the same word on the other. There's a swapped alignment, where a child and a parent on one side map to an inverse relationship, like in the German example. And then we simply have a case with no alignment, where we may have a word aligned with another word, but something spontaneous intervening node, or an may kind of break that break what otherwise would be a match. So we define some operations that correspond to those different alignment types. We have a merge operation, where if we have multiply aligned words, we simply combine them and promote the children of the child node to be parents of the new merged node. We have the swap operation, where we swap the child with the parent and move the children along with it. And we have the remove node, which is essentially like the merge, or remove operation, which is essentially like the merge operation, except we don't rename the new merged node. So with these operations, we can go about calculating the divergence between the tree banks. So using those different alignment types, we perform the corresponding operation, and before and after, we calculate the edge match percentage to see what impact there is by applying that operation. And as we go all the way through, we eventually end up with a two different languages, or two different trees that should resemble each other maximally after taking into account all of those divergences. So just to walk through what that looks like, first we start off with a bi-text. In this case, it's actually an interlinear gloss text. so the it's not shown here, but there's a one-to-one correspondence between the source language here, which is Hindi, and the English gloss text here. So each one of these tokens aligns directly with the one beneath it. Then we can get word alignment through matching the gloss with the word in the translation. So we end up with trees. These are actually the gold trees that look something like this. As you can see, there's a significant difference between the caused given in English and the give with a causative marker on it. So first, we identify the words that are spontaneous that weren't shown in that alignment, and remove those, then we still have a multiply aligned with the caused given versus the give causative, and we want to merge that. And in between each one of these steps, as we remove these nodes, the percentage of the match between the trees increases because now we no longer have those edges that are unaligned. And as we merge these two nodes, we lose a edge that's no longer, or that wasn't matching previously between book and cause on this side and what would be book and cause on this side. So we did this on four different language pairs: English Hindi, English Swedish, English German, and German Swedish. And we started off with just the baseline before we apply any operation of how many matches there were in the tree bank. Then we removed every node that every spontaneous word from tree bank, see how what the match looked like then. Then applied merge and then swap. One thing that I should point out too is there are two numbers listed here. There's for English to Hindi and Hindi to English. Because the denominator essentially in the percentage is the number of edges in that tree for the language, it's actually an asymmetrical measure. They're generally similar-ish once we've removed, especially after we've removed spontaneous words. But yeah, it is asymmetrical. So one thing that was, they all correspond pretty similarly in jumps after removal, after merge, after swap. One interesting thing is the Hindi at the very end is at 90% match. All the other languages are at 78 to 80% match. So this first table here is actually from the Hindi English tree bank, and it was actually guideline sentences. It's very clean, clear translations. The other three tables here are from the Smultron database, which has, again, supervised parallel trees, but the sentences are much looser translations of one another. So after applying our operations, it still seems that there's quite a bit of a gap to be closed. So we drilled down a little bit deeper, trying to get a breakdown of the operations as they applied to different part of speech tags. in English and Hindi, that we see that verbs collapse with other verbs a lot, like in the give cause version, especially with auxiliary verbs. Hindi tends to have those outlined. In English and German, we see that nouns collapse pretty frequently with other nouns, as German does a lot of compounding that English doesn't. For swaps, there's a lot of head changing in the verbs in Hindi, so the English verbs will often change heads with the English the aligned verbs in Hindi. And then again in German, some of the compounding between the tree banks causes nouns to swap position. And then finally, just removals. Determiners tended to be the most kind of spontaneous between Indian or English and Hindi. English and German had other determiners that just didn't match. And there are some interesting German specific prepositions that got removed in the German case. So what we've done, just to review, is defined three operations that capture common divergence patterns, measured the language or the effect of those operations on the four language pairs. And so what we want to do as future work is perform these same tests on a much broader selection of languages. Ideally, since we have interlinear text in ODIN, which is a lot like the interlinear text we use for Hindi, we should be able to run that on upwards of 100 languages. We can try learning the high-frequency transformation and apply those as rewrite rules to projected trees. Or what we're working on right now is actually using the inferred patterns to inform a dependency parser that is trained across parallel tree banks and then is fed parallel text. And yeah, we got quite a bit of time for questions.
Hi, it was a good talk, thanks. I'm not a native speaker of Hindi, but from what I could see, it looks a bit artificial sentence. So yeah. I was wondering if the numbers that you showed is an indicative of the nature of the corpus or...
Yeah, so these sentences are... So interlinear text does tend to have a slight bias in that it is usually instructive sentences that are highlighting specific differences between whatever the linguist's native language and the target language is. So there can be a bit of a bias in those interlinear examples. So that does seem a little artificial to you. Yeah, I mean the Odin database has. For some languages, it's got thousands of IGTs. For some, it's only got 20 or 30. We have seen that when you get enough examples, the stiltedness of a couple of the sentences will tend to average out as the linguists look at different effect or different factors of the language. But yeah, some of the individual examples can be a little biased for instructive purposes.
Okay, but do you know where this corpus was collected from? Like, are these?
So these sentences in the Hindi English were actually guideline sentences for annotating the Hindi Urdu tree bank, okay. Which I believe I have the citation down here. I think that's still in progress. Yeah, the one at the top there. So these in particular are going to be super. Super instructive, so that the annotators can pick up the right thing to do.
Okay, thanks.
So I just got a question about the results that you showed. So the previous slide, yes. After the remove and merge steps, how many edges are you basically knocking out of the tree? And
yeah.
Is there a trivial solution that gives you a tree with one node in it on both sides that gets 100% on all of these metrics?
Yeah. So no, we never get that that bad. The trees are pretty well. So the alignments that we actually have were done first statistically and then corrected by hand. So they're basically hand alignments, and most of the stuff's in there. I don't have the numbers up on here, but I think from beginning to end, it was roughly a third of the edges, a third reduction in the edges.
Okay. And these numbers are, that's basically the denominator is changing here, right? When
yeah.
you remove,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, so it goes from, yeah, yeah, exactly.
Okay. Okay, that's
yeah.
fine.
Yeah.
Third, yeah, just, thanks.
Yeah, occasionally there can be some cases where the numerator will change as we merge something that was also aligned, but the denominator will decrease at the same time.
Sure, so, okay.
Yeah.
I have two quick comments.
Yeah.
First, so I think it's the next slide where you break it down by part of speech. I'd also be interested in, at the lexical level, there might be like specific verbs
yeah,
like
yeah.
like versus gern.
Yeah, yeah.
That might be accounting for a large percentage of
yeah.
what actually happens. So it'd be interesting to see if there's just a few examples that a few specific constructions that account for everything, or if it's a wider divergence between the two languages.
Yeah, yeah. So, I mean, with the Hindi examples in particular, the tree bank, I'm not a Hindi speaker, so I didn't know. If the case markings in a lot of cases are separate words that aren't mapping onto English, and that I'm guessing is a pretty closed class that would probably see the same repetition over and over again. So yeah, that lexically it would be probably an interesting breakdown too. Yeah, good point.
And I'd also point you to work by Lori Levin and Alain Levy on, they didn't do dependency parsing, it was syntactic parsing, but it was very similar trying to project the two trees to each other. Yeah. So I'll give you that reference later.
Cool, thanks.